Challenge is, it's a fairly complex thing, so I'm trying to boil it down to something that's easy to understand. Obviously, I'm not meeting the mark here, so.
So if you pick up an example, like if you pick up, like, say, okay, we can serve all of this market, but I want to just drive you to an earthquake, volcano, anything, but specific, yes. Because when you come as, you know, I can do everything with everybody and the market is big and blah, 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 it just makes me feel like you are so not grounded in the market, which is not the case, okay?
What you could do is talk about this, you know, when this slide comes up.
And you say, for example,
here we have a flood. And what you get is information around, and I'll change this out because this is a earthquake thing, I'll change it out to a flooding picture and say they'd be managing resources like police cars to block off roads that are flooded, fire department to go through flooded neighborhoods because their trucks are high and they can, you know, rescue stranded people and stuff.
Yeah, I like the idea of using a really kind of concrete, realistic use case, ideally something that you kind of done in the past, and something that represents an opportunity that you'd like to replicate with, say, like Canadian customers, right? Because then that will give them a sense of, oh, okay, this applies to me, or maybe it doesn't apply to me, or I know someone that you should meet.
Okay.
Or like the Calgary floods. It actually interests me when you were going through that. I was actually thinking in my head, oh, this would be a great opportunity to forecast, work through potential future floods.
Yeah, there's a lot of illustrations. I have to be clear on this because there's a lot of deep knowledge and there's not enough time to get through. So, like one quick example was everyone came out and the city put dump trucks and bonus so people could empty their basements out and everything. But the next day they said, oh, and by the way, you should be wearing a mask because there's a lot of dirty stuff in there, and that was too little, too late.
Yeah.
Example of how it could be coordinated.
So you can give an example. The last one is when you talk about your revenues, it looks to me like it's a human capital intensive service. Yeah, when you talk about this, this is human capital intensive service. You talk about management consultant, they will come back to you, the way it's here, recurrent re-engagement, this is a very intensive capital, human capital. It contradicts with the concept of SaaS model.
It declines over time. It's actually a two-phase model. So
yeah, just you don't have to defend it. This is my feeling. Like, it must be a way to show that this is, it can work on its own with the least amount of humans.
Well, the reason it does decline over time is we actually train them up so they end up doing it themselves. But initially, it's all new to them. So it's like developing a new skill set. It takes time for them to get good at it. And the time is a couple years.
Can I give a few thoughts or observations? So this slide in particular, you have too much on the slide. You have too much good stuff. So I'm almost wondering if you could send me your slide deck and if I could just show you how I would read it. Because it would be easier than me just I like the way that you presented all the content. I think a lot of the content is really good. But like for example, the management team stuff, I would actually put that kind of top and center on the team page. If you go back in terms of like the revenue and financials and everything, if you don't actually want to put up a graph of financials, I think that's fine. But I would also split like revenue from investment ROI probably. Like I would probably make those two separate slides. I would talk a little bit more about kind of that business model, how you like kind of what Wael had just said about, how does this actually work in terms of, they pay for an upfront management consulting piece. We then implement the solution, we walk them through that first part, but as it moves forward, there's a recurring revenue component where we kind of phase ourselves out and we continue to cash checks.
Yeah, I can explain that. Because the upfront is, it's basically around 400 to 450 hours of management consulting activity that declines into a recurring SaaS model.
So, as an investor, what I would like to get is 75% or more of my investment will go to marketing and sales so they can recover quickly on payback from clients. If I see that you have extremely high intensive capital, human capital required, this is some type of investors who would like to come and play with the engineers. But as like Arlene and this kind of investor at this level, They need to see you in the market in front of customers. You need to be in front of 10 more customers, give you money to be in front of 10 more customers. But not one more development. It's all, which is concept, me and you on the engineering side don't understand it. This is what I know from this business. So this is, for me, is a very high human capital intensive project. It's not a sales, it's not a SaaS revenue. You may want to remove the SaaS revenue, you may want to remove the current engagement. You may want to just try to talk more about the service will be out there, we will train somebody, he will sell, we will sell more without asking back for human capital.
Oh, well, I'll be perfectly clear because I'm not selling this as a SaaS model, because it isn't. It's half and half, really. And you know, they're both working together cooperatively, and it's done through consultants. So the number of employees in the company stays very small, and the consultant piece grows. We act as the trainers for those folks. Just FYI.
Well, even if you think about IBM, like that's essentially IBM's model too, right? Like it's a very compelling.
Yeah, and it's lucrative, provided you're providing something that people value highly.
Yeah.
And, you know, if the comparison is spending, you know, $450,000 compared with losing $10 million or something, and you save that, you know, a couple $1 million a year, you're definitely going to spend the $450,000.
Okay.
While we're on that slide, I find the red very jarring and counterproductive, because to me, red means stop, danger, keep away. So I wouldn't use red. Going back to in the presentation, much along what Wales said, when you're using words like trying to save companies' money, it should be more effective. We do save companies' money. And you also, when you talk about 9/11,
we can charge your percentage.
Well, just your verbal comments. Yeah. When you
said, okay.
You also said that you talk about 9/11. You said they were all killed. Well, only 2,550,000 were killed. So what's
no, all of those people that I briefed were dead. So it was the worst presentation.
So you can't say,
would not reference that at all.
Yeah.
In a presentation, there's two things. It doesn't matter if you believe in climate change or not. I would not say anything about climate change because immediately you're going to get.
I actually made a note of that.
Yeah,
as well,
you're going to get half. You're going to get at least half the audience then going, huh? And then they're not going to listen to anything else you say because they're going to get stuck on it.
Because they're focused on that, yeah.
Yeah, so anything that could be like politically or like kind of poke people in a way that is going to get them thinking about that comment versus the really good stuff that you're doing, because you don't want people thinking about that.
Yeah.
So I would try to find, I love the idea of you, so what I really loved, what you don't know can hurt your bottom line. I really like that. I like the idea of starting with the tagline. I think that's really good, and it's talking about this uncertainty factor. I would try to find another example a little less jarring than 9/11. Like, ideally not something where people have died, but ideally something where people have lost a lot of money. So Calgary flood would be a really great example. Snowtember, like something local. It could be something broader. It could be a hurricane or typhoon.
Or big Murray fires.
Yeah, there's a number that I could pull off.
Yeah, so I would use kind of either one example or like two or three examples. So either keep it at like one or two or three. But I would focus on something where there's kind of that human element. But I would stay away from like terrorism or anything because like just you don't.
There is some sensitive stuff.
But I do get why you use that because the personal backstory there was really great.
Yeah, and I didn't want to get into them.
Bruce, so I don't know, slightly different approach than that. I'm glad you're at the front side there. If your backstory is going to be the World Trade Center, I'm not sure why you have that slide. Just to hear hanging with me. If your backstory is going to be World Trade Center, have a picture of the World Trade Center.
Yeah.
And then, if that's going to be your story, start with a picture of that. And then you said, well, it kind of inspired you, but then you said, maybe we could have done something, maybe we couldn't. I don't want to hear maybe, yes, maybe not. Don't get off into, I don't want to hear that. Something could have been, so I want you here to say, as an expert on emergent preparedness, something could have been that. Well, then I was inspired to do something. But now, if you don't want to use that story, use a different story.
Well,
I'm sorry. I want you to get my point out here. But what I don't get is, you said, what you don't know can't hurt you, but you never referred to that.
which you don't know can hurt your bottom line.
I know, but you didn't even reference.
Yeah. So the idea